Good afternoon, distinguished colleagues and guests. Today it is the 7th of October 2021, 2 p.m. according to Moscow time. Allow me to consider open the meeting of the Dissertation Council for the defense of Yevgeny Nazarchuk's dissertation for the degree of the Doctor of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences in the Scientific Specialization 25005 Mineralogy, Earth Science Institute, St. Petersburg State University, on the topic Crystal Chemistry of Uranyl Chromates, Molybdates and Related Compounds. According to the order of Alexander Gnotov, St. Petersburg State University Scientific Secretary, dated from the 3rd of June 2021, number 5985/1, me, Sergey Britvin, Doctor of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences, Professor of the Department of Crystallography, St. Petersburg University, Earth Science Institute, was appointed the chairperson of this dissertation council. According to our technical reasons, Mr. Thorsen, our board member, who is in the remote interactive mode, he can't hear you, and we announced technical breaks for several minutes. I announced technical break number one. Please switch off the connection.
Вот, конечно, то, что телефона не было, это, конечно, не очень хорошо.
Hello, it is the interpreter. Can you hear me?
Слышит, слышит. Please say a few words. Because we can't hear you. I won't listen.
So that seems to work from my side.
Okay, we can hear you.
You can hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so then everything's fine. Thank you.
Distinguished colleagues, I declare, I announce short technical break number one finished. Nazarchuk Yevgeny Vasilievich is going to defend his thesis. Of my fellow board members who were approved by the same order, and let me introduce them. Olga Frank-Kamenetska, Doctor of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences, Professor of the Department of Crystallography, St. Petersburg University. Vladislav Blatov, Doctor of Chemical Sciences, Professor, Head of the General and Inorganic Chemistry Department, Samara State Technical University. Yevgeny Sulimanov, Doctor of Chemical Sciences, Professor, Director of the Research Institute for Chemistry, Lobachevsky State University of Nizhny Novgorod.
Apart from that, in the remote interactive mode, we have got Natalia Zubkova, Doctor of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences, Associate Professor of the Geological Faculty, Lomonosov Moscow State University. Natalia Vitalievna, can you see and hear us? Yes, I can. And our foreign colleague from Germany, Thorsten Giesing, PhD, University of Bremen, Germany. Can you see and hear us?
Yes, I can see and hear you.
All board members are here. Also, here with us, there is a scientific advisor, Doctor of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences, Professor of the Department of Crystallography of Science Institute, St. Petersburg University, Alex Sidra. To improve the quality of communication, I ask you, dear colleagues, those who are in the remote interactive mode, to turn off your microphones. But do not forget to turn them on when you are given the floor. I also inform you that audio and video recording of our meeting is being conducted, as well as the live broadcast on the St. Petersburg University website. Simultaneous interpretation of speeches from Russian into English and from English into Russian is being provided. On the screen of the direct broadcast, I can see an email. An email address is posted on the live broadcast of the meeting of the Dissertation Council, where during the meeting all listeners can express their opinions and set questions to the applicant online concerning his dissertation and the current scientific discussion of his speech. This These questions will be forwarded to me by the technical services, and I will voice them during the discussion. Questions must be related to the applicant's presentation and the content of his dissertation. No accidental questions, and the name, position, and place of work of the author of the question must be indicated. Questions that are not related to the scientific discussion, to the discussion of the dissertation, to the text and assessment of the dissertation itself, will not be voiced. In accordance with the procedure for awarding the academic degree of Candidate of Sciences, academic degree of Doctor of Sciences at St. Petersburg University, approved by local regulations of St. Petersburg University, hereinafter the procedure, a meeting of the Dissertation Council is considered eligible if at least two-thirds of the approved membership of the Council takes part in its work, but not less than four people. Our Dissertation Council consists of six members are present, including two members in the remote interactive mode. All members of the Dissertation Council and the applicant are provided with audiovisual contact, thus there is quorum. Dear employee of the Dissertation Department, please compose the application, this sheet. Special application sheet. Now there are some formalities. The procedure of today's meeting of the Dissertation Council with a total duration of approximately 3 hours is the following. First, a brief report of the chairman on the documents submitted by the applicant for a scientific degree and their compliance with the established regulation. Answers to possible questions, about 5 minutes. Number two, a short presentation by the... No voice in the microphone, unfortunately. Questions to the applicant strictly according to his report, no more than 2 minutes per questions. A short presentation by the applicant for a scientific degree, it's point two, reflecting the main points of his research, approximately 40 minutes, we have decided so. Then questions to the applicant strictly according to his report, no more than 2 minutes per question. Answers of the applicant, no more than 15 minutes for all questions. Number five, speeches of all members of the dissertation council in turn, with their assessment of the dissertation research, with a summary of their positions, with questions and suggestions for the dissertation, about 10 minutes per speaker. Then, the speech of the chairman with his review, about 10 minutes. Answers of the applicant for a scientific degree to questions and comments of the members of the dissertation council, no more than 20 minutes. Number eight, open discussion. Speeches at the request of those present at the defense of the dissertation, with a summary of their positions and specific questions and proposals for the dissertation, strictly on the topic of the research. No more than 2 minutes for everyone. At the same time, all interested people are requested to register in the registration form and completely introduce themselves before their performance and indicate status, position, and place of work. Then, presentation by the chairman of questions addressed to the applicant, which came in order to discuss his speech and scientific discussion on the broadcast of the meeting of the Dissertation Council on the St. Petersburg University website. If there are long questions, more than 2 minutes, they won't be voiced. Number 10, answers of the applicant, no more than 2 minutes per question. 11, speech of the scientific advisor of the applicant, a short presentation, no more than 3 minutes. 12, discussion of the results of the defense by the members of the dissertation board before the open vote, during which the sound of the broadcast is muted, about 5 minutes, private discussion. 13, open roll call, the most important point of our agenda, counting of votes by the chairman of the dissertation council with the entry of the results into the minutes of the meeting. 14, making a decision on awarding or not awarding an academic degree. Concluding remarks of the applicant, very brief, no more than 2 minutes. 15 points, we have to go through them. Dear colleagues, are there any questions or objections to this regulation? No objections? If there are no objections, I will proceed to the implementation of the rules of the meeting. But before, please turn off the sound of your mobile phones. And dear colleagues who are in the remote interactive mode, please don't switch off your mobile phones and keep them within the reach. In order to solve problems in case of technical breakdowns. So I'm starting to conduct the meeting. Number one. Chairman's brief report. The dissertation of Evgeny Nazarchuk for the degree of the Doctor of Mineralogical Sciences in Specialization 25 0005, mineralogy crystallography, on the topic crystal chemistry of uranyl chromates, molybdates, and related compounds, was accepted for the defense by the order of Alexander Gnotov, the academic secretary of St. Petersburg University, from 14th of May 2021, number 4874/1. Evgeny Nazarchuk wrote his dissertation research on the basis of St. Petersburg University. His scientific advisor, Doctor of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences, Professor of the Department of Crystallography, Earth Science Institute, St. Petersburg University, Alexandra, the number of publications of the applicant in which the main scientific results of the dissertation are stated, according to the list presented, 37 publications. There is one article in peer-reviewed scientific publications from the list approved by the Ministry of Education and Science of the Russian Federation. There are 36 publications in journals indexed in the Centrometric Databases Web of Science and Scopus. The applicant for the degree submitted to the scientific secretary of St. Petersburg University a complete package of the documents for acceptance, for consideration, and defense of the thesis. All the documents are stored in the applicant certification file. Their copies are held by an employee of the Department for Maintenance, the activities of dissertation councils, who is now in the hall. Before giving the floor to the applicant, dear members of the dissertation board, do you have general questions to the applicant? And if there is a necessity to announce and consider the entire list of documents submitted by the applicant for the defense. If there are some questions, please voice them. No questions. And now the report of our candidates, 40 minutes, is given to you. Evgeny, this floor is yours. Thank you very much. Sergey Nikolaevich, can you hear me well? Distinguished chairman, distinguished board members, dear guests, allow me to introduce my report on the topic crystal chemistry of uranyl chromates, molybdates, and related compounds. I would like to start my talk with a quote from the work of Dmitry Mendeleev. Convinced that the study of uranium, starting from its natural sources, will lead to many more new discoveries, I boldly recommend that those who are looking for subjects for new research especially carefully study uranium compounds. Natural and man-made uranium compounds are of undoubted interest from both a fundamental and practical point of view. In nature, hexavalent uranium compounds are formed in the oxidation zones of uranium deposits. The study of mineral associations makes it possible to establish the forms of occurrence and migration of radionuclides in the geological environment. The use of atomic energy is increasingly raising the issue of the safe disposal of spent nuclear fuel. Despite the fact that this issue has been closely studied for more than 40 years, the processes occurring in spent nuclear fuel remain poorly understood. It is of interest to study the phase formation both in the SNF solution itself and during the interaction of SNF with the contained material and rocks of the geological burial ground. The SNF composition is very complex. Spent nuclear fuel always contains molybdenium isotopes. Sulfate and chloride reprocessing cycles additionally enrich SNF. The use of chrome-plated steels in the manufacture of canisters for holding and storing spent nuclear fuel, as well as the use of potassium dichromate as an additive to the coolant, leads to the fact that the content of chromium oxide in high-level waste reaches 0.3 gram per kilogram.
Mineralov.
The formation of oxidation zones of uranium deposits can be divided into several stages according to the acidity of crystallization solutions. At the initial stage, while the conditions are alkaline and neutral, the primary minerals of tetravalent uranium are oxidized with the formation of minerals with mixed valence of uranium, uranyl hydroxide, and silicates. In the extreme case, the conditions in the oxidation zones can again return to alkaline with the formation of secondary cementation zones. All natural and synthetic compounds of hexavalent uranium can be roughly divided into three large groups: inorganic compounds, templated compounds, and hybrid phases, in which organic molecules are involved in the coordination of uranium. The latter compounds are not considered in the scope of this thesis. In mineral structures, hexavalent uranium is, as a rule, coordinated in the vertical plane by two oxygen at the distance of about 1.8, and it received the name of uranyl ion. In the horizontal plane, the uranyl ion can be coordinated by 4, 5, or 6 ligands to form a tetragonal, pentagonal, or hexagonal D-pyramid. The way of combining uranium polyhedra in the structures of minerals is specified by the conditions of their formation. In the structures of minerals that crystallize under the alkaline and neutral conditions, uranium polyhedra joining along the edges are capable of forming island chain and layered complexes. In the presence of additional anions under these conditions, the character of the interaction of the polyhedra does not change. Uranium polyhedra are combined along the edges with each other and with polyhedra of additional cations to form layers. Within the framework of this work, we investigate uranyl compounds obtained by crystallization from acidic solutions. Both inorganic compounds and compounds templated by organic molecules are investigated. In order to establish the effect of the size and type of template or heterophyllohedral structures, a wide range of alkali and alkaline earth metals, as well as organic templates from simple amines to large as a crown ethers are used in synthesis. The synthesis were carried out by solid phase and hydrothermal methods, as well as by other thermal evaporation. The obtained compounds were studied using a standard complex of crystal chemical methods. For each compound, in addition to X-ray diffraction studies, the composition was confirmed by the microprobe method and IR spectra was recorded. The DTA curves were recorded for the compound studied by the thermal X-ray method. And we have discovered a new island complex built by combining two uranium polyhedra along a peroxide edge. The resulting dimer is encrusted with two NO3 groups. Note that this island complex has zero charge. In addition to the described island complex, the structure of the studied compound contains electrically neutral crown ether molecules. In some structures, uranium has a different coordination from the traditional one. In the calcium uranyl telluride, the uranium atom in the vertical plane is coordinated by two oxygens at a distance of about 2.2, and in the equatorial plane by four oxygens with a shorter bond length. This anti-uranyl coordination is called the tetroxide nucleus. In the structure of the studied compound, the uranyl polyhedra combine at the vertices to form chains. One of the most common chains is the structure of uranyl compounds is 1D0 chain. The chain is built by combining uranium polyhedra and tetrahedral cations along the vertices with the ratio UO2 TO4 equals 1:1. The chain has zero charge. Such chains have been described in the structure of schamvite mineral. The simplest transformation of the addition of NO3 groups to the chain to form uranyl O2 TO4 NO3 chains. There are 41 known connections based on the ID0 chain, both simple aqueous compounds and phases templated with various amines are known. In the structure of this compound, six types of arrangement of chains in unit cells are noted. Let's project the axis of the chains on the plane of elementary cells and connect the resulting points with segments. As a result, we get six hexagonal grids with different degrees of distortion, in which each hex is centered. All of them can be reduced to a single ideal hexagonal grid without breaking the bonds. Thus, the position of the chain axis is fixed in the unit cell of the compounds, and their mutual reversal depends on the size and shape of the cations located between the chain. In the structures of uranyl compounds, the greatest topological diversity is characteristic of layered complexes formed by combining uranium polyhedra and tetrahedral oxyanions at the vertices. The layers are usually divided according to the value of the UO2-TO4 ratio. Layers are separated with the ratio of 1 to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 2, 3 to 5, 4 to 7, 5 to 8. The greatest topological diversity is typical for layers with a ratio of 2 to 3. There are 9 types of such layers. Let us consider 2 to 3 layers. If we divide layers 2 to 3 into chains A and layers 3 to 5 into ribbons B and combine the resulting complexes in the sequence, then we get layers 5 to 8. It turns out such an interesting math. 2 to 3 plus 3 to 5 equals 5 to 8. As noted above, 3 to 5 layers can be divided into chains, and this, at the same time, three types of chains are required to build a layer. In the work of Krivovichev, it was noted that 3 to 5 layers, following the example of a graphene layer, can be considered as phototypes for creating inorganic uranium nanotubes. Take, for example, the smallest known inorganic uranium nanotube. The figure shows clearly that its walls are built of three types of chains. In the structure of uranyl compounds, there are three inorganic nanotubes. If each of them is cut along the elongation and unfolded, a layered prototype can be found for each tube. At the same time, each of these tubes can be represented as a set of chains. The smallest tube is built of six chains. The middle one is 9, and the largest is 10. In the smallest tube, a set of three chains will be repeated twice, and in the middle one three times. This indicates that the prototypes of these tubes are layers with a ratio of 3 to 5, but in the largest tube, a set of five chains is repeated twice. Apparently, a prototype of this tube is layers with a ratio of 5 to 8. Considering the walls of nanotubes as modular structures built by combining chains makes it possible to predict the topologies of not yet discovered nanotubes. All of the above is the essence of the first protected provision. The topological diversity of heteropolyhedral chains, layers, and frameworks in the structures of hexavalent uranium compounds with TO oxyanions according to the crystal chemistry, uranyl chromates occupy an intermediate position between sulfates and selenates. Many compounds are isostructural. However, chromates have a number of features primarily associated with the ability of the chromatinion to polymerize with the formation groups. In nature, the formation of uranium and chromium is confined to different geochemical environments, so researchers are following the path of studying synthetic compounds. Among the structures of uranyl chromates, classical examples of structural organization are noted. in the structure of lithium uranyl chromate, uranyl polyhedra, and chromate tetrahedra combine at the vertices to form layers between which lithium atoms and water molecules are located. This structural arrangement, which is very characteristic of uranyl compounds, can be described in terms of the guest-host principle. The host is the uranyl chromate layers, and the guest is the lithium polyhedra. The opposite example demonstrates the structure of potassium uranyl chromate dichromate. In this case, dichromate groups combine with potassium atoms from layers between which the island complexes UO2, CaO4 are located. In contrast to the structure of uranyl sulfates and especially uranyl selenates in the structures of uranyl chromates, the polyhedra of uranium and chromium are often combined along the edge. For example, the structure of the uranyl chromate shown in the figure shows an island complex built by combining the uranium polyhedra CaO4 group along the edge. Another example of bidentate interaction of uranium and chromium polyhedra is the chains that we found in the structures of cesium and rubidium uranyl chromates. The combination of clusters that make up the chains in the mineral Liuk-Bogate and the previously described island complexes leads to the formation of layers in the structure of the compound shown in the slide. Another distinctive feature of the structures of uranyl chromates is the ability of the uranyl ion to exhibit several types of coordination within one structure. In the structure of the studied uranyl chromate, the uranyl ion has a pentagonal and hexagonal d-pyramid coordination. Such a possibility was described earlier in the structure of the phosphorinolite mineral. However, in this case, in the layer, uranium polyhedra were combined with each other along the edges. In the structures of uranyl compounds, nitrate complexes often play a reducing role. By joining the equatorial edges of uranyl polyhedra, they virtually exclude the possibility of further polymerization of this polyhedra. In the structures of these compounds, the uranium and chromium polyhedra are combined at the vertices to form chains. An additional nitrate group is added to each uranium polyhedron. As a result, the chains are combined into layers, positions relative to each other like steps at a staircase. This type of layer in the structures of uranyl compounds was noted for the first type. Very often in the structures of uranium compounds, uranyl polyhedra join together along the edges to form tricycle clusters. Such clusters are well known in the structures of uranyl sulfates and uranyl selenates. They are noted in the structure of the alvixinite mineral and in the structure of uranopyrite. Such clusters combine along the edges to form clusters, the polymerization of which leads to the formation of zipped chains in the structure of the mineral of the same name. Layers of a ratio of 2 to 3 are an excellent example of the topological diversity of layers built by combining uranium and chromium polyhedra at the vertices. In the structures of the compounds presented, there are 1 and 2 to 3 layers of the same type per unit cell. In this structure, there are 4 layers per unit cell. 2 of them correspond to the previously designated layers of type A, and the other 2, despite their superficial similarity, have a different topology and a different graph. Let us designate them as type B layers. The formation of such connection can be represented as the mutual penetration of two structures built from layers of type A and type B respectively. An increase in the acidity of the crystallization solutions A solution leads to polymerization of chromates, tetrahedra, and crystallization of dichromates. For example, in the structure of cesium uranyl dichromate, two hexagonal uranium dipyramids encrusted with the nitrate complexes combined with two dichromate groups to form an island complex. The chains built on the basis of dichromate complexes remain stable upon crystallization from aqueous solutions in the presence of both relatively simple amines in the and large as a crown ethers. High values of acidity of crystallization solution, uranyl chromate, chromate dichromates are formed. In the structure presented on the slide, we found chains built from 1D0 chains encrusted with chromos 207 groups. More complex ribbons are described in compounds prepared from solutions containing other crown ether molecules. Due to the surface charge, these large organic molecules apparently prevent the polymerization of heteropolyhedral uranyl chromate structures into complexes of higher dimension. The ribbons in the first joint are built on the basis of YD0 chains. Only in this case, the chains are inlaid sequentially with two dichromate groups and one chromate tetrahedron. An even more complex version of the tape was found in the connections shown on the slide. The tape is constructed by combining two types of dichromate groups, single chromos 04 tetrahedra and uranyl polyhedra. The similarity of the structures of uranyl chromates with the structures of uranyl arsenate and uranyl phosphates dismantle the uranyl chromate dichromate layers. Note that these layers can be viewed as modular units built by combining 1D0 chains and dichromate groups. The interaction of these layers and interlayer cations in the structures of uranyl chromates can lead to the formation of both centrosymmetric and non-centrosymmetric structures. A further increase in the acidity of the crystallization solution in the presence of crown ether molecules leads to the crystallization of the compound. And this is the first example of a compound that simultaneously contains three types of chromate complexes. During my report, I gave examples of crystal structures of uranyl chromates containing mono and bidental interactions between uranium and chromium polyhedra, different degrees of polymerization of chromate tetrahedra, several coordination of uranium within one structure. The uniqueness of uranyl chromates lies in the fact that all these features can manifest themselves in one structure at the same time. For example, in the structure shown on the slide, uranium has the coordination of a penta and hexagonal pyramid. Hexavalent chromium is located in the tetrahedra. Chromate tetrahedra polymerized to form chromos 207 groups. Uranium and chromium polyhedra are combined along vertical and edges. As a result, hemispheres with the size of 18.9 by 18.5 A and height of 8 A are formed. Chromates remain the least studied class in terms of the number of studied structures, 14%. On the other hand, chromates have all the characteristics of the more studied classes. In chromates as well as in sulfates, mono and bidental interactions of uranium, polyhedra and tetrahedral anions are observed. Chromates are characterized by high flexibility, bonds almost the same as in molybdates. All of the above mentioned is the essence of the second provision for the defense. Uranyl chromates are the most structurally diverse class among compounds with T6 plus O4 groups. Their topological diversity is provided by the ability to polymerized chromium O4 tetrahedra. And all of these above features can be implemented in one structure. Polymerization of chromium O4 groups is provided by the concentration of solutions of chromic and dichromic acids, which control the pH of the medium. Temperature is one of the most important parameters affecting phase formation in SNF. In order to study the thermal behavior of a number of uranyl compounds, we carried out thermal X-ray diffraction experiment. The results obtained were confirmed by DTA and DSC data. Calcium uranyl telluride is stable up to a temperature of 700 plus minus 25 degrees Celsius, after which it decomposes with the formation of a calcium UO4. Graphs of the dependence of the parameters of the unit cell of the compound on the temperature are linear and are well approximated by polynomials of the first degree. Potassium uranyl telluride is stable up to temperature of 600 degrees Celsius, at which it decomposes with the formation. The thermal expansion of the compound is sharply azeotropic. If we take the temperature of 625 plus minus 25 degrees centigrade, at which a sharp jump occurs on the graphs of the parameters and volume of the unit cell on temperature, and the motif of the structure changes from frame to layered. A reconstructive phase transition is noted in this case. The thermal expansion of the frame structure is anisotropic. Large channels are distinguished in the framework. The maximum expansion corresponds to the largest radius of the channels in the structure. Thermal expansion perpendicular to the layers is minimal, and in the place of the layer is maximal. The layers in the structure are highly corrugated with an increase in temperature due to the flexibility of the UO bonds. The layers are straightened, compensating for the external effect. And the compound Cesius-2 is stable up to temperature of 450 degrees Celsius, after which it decomposes with the formation of Cesius-2. As a result, hexavalent chromium is reduced to pentavalent and changes its coordination from tetrahedral to tetragonal pyramidal. We were able to study the thermal expansion of both compounds. We also managed to study the thermal expansion of the recrystallization product, Cesius-2. The thermal expansion of Cesius is also sharply anisotropic. All of the above is the essence of the third provision for the defense. The nature of the anisotropy of thermal deformations and the variety of phase transformations of the studied tellurides, chromates, and uranyl molybdates are determined by tetrahedral cations. Phase transformation in the case of uranyl tellurides are due to the oxidation. In case of uranyl chromates, under acidic conditions, it is sometimes possible to obtain uranyl compounds from solution, the structures of which are built on the basis of microporous frameworks. In case of such compounds, the acidity of the crystallization medium and dehydration processes play an important role. We obtained three uranyl sulfates templated with pyridinium molecules from an aqueous solution as a result of successive recrystallization. As a result of recrystallization, the symmetry of the compound first changes from the monolithic to rhombic, and the volume doubles. In the third step, the volume returns to almost its original values. The crystal structure of the first uranyl sulfate is a framework which channels 1.22 multiple 0.6 nanometers in size. The framework is constructed from chains connected by additional uranyl polyhedra, and at the last step of the dehydration, the compound completely loses water, and its structure changes from a framework to lead one. We managed to obtain the first rubidium uranyl chromates, the structures of which are built on the basis of frameworks. Compounds crystallize from one another as a result of dehydration, despite the fact that the difference between the compounds is only three water molecules. The topology of the framework is the following. As a result of recrystallization, the motif of the framework changes. The scaffold of the second uranyl chromate is built from 1D0 chains interconnected by chromite tetrahedra. The framework contains two systems of channels with a maximum size of 1.05 to 0.7 nanometers. Microporous frameworks in the structures of uranyl compounds are not always built only from uranium polyhedra and tetrahedral anions. In the structures of the compounds shown on the slide, polyhedra of sodium atoms are also involved in the construction of frameworks. In uranyl sulfate, sodium polyhedra combine with each other to act as a guest connecting the uranyl sulfate layers into a framework. As a result of crystallization from an aqueous solution containing phenylglycine molecules, uranyl sulfate was found, the structure of which is built on the basis of nanotubes. This is the third example of an inorganic nanotube complex in the structures of uranyl compounds. The nanotube size is 2.2 to 1.4 nanometers. Each nanotube is built of rings connected by additional tetrahedrons. If we unfold such a ring on a plane, then we get the well-known chain ID0. If you cut the nanotube along the elongation and unfold it on a plane, you get a layer with the ratio UO2 to SO4 equals 3 to 5. In terms of size, the described uranyl sulfate nanotubes occupy an intermediate position between the already known uranyl selenate nanotubes. All of the above mentioned is the explains the fourth provision for the defense. Based on the synthesis and structural studies of 16 new microporous uranyl compounds with TO4 oxyanions, the topological similarity of some of them is shown. Thus, among the studied microporous sulfates and molybdates of uranyl, most often the framework is realized, and the frameworks in chromates and selenates uranyl are topological isomers. As a result of works, 37 articles were published in scientific journals. Thank you very much for your attention. Evgeny Vasilievich, thank you very much. It took you 30 minutes to present your report. It means that we have got enough time. Are there any volunteers to ask questions strictly according to the topic of the report, short questions? If there are no questions, I have one question, small question. It has nothing to do with the essence of your study. It has nothing to do. Of course, it refers to the topic of your report, but Wolframus, thank you for your question. We tried to conduct it experiences Wolframates. When we use our methodology and approach, we could not receive such compounds. We tried temperature synthesis, but we did not manage to obtain it. Its behavior is different. There is no solid phase synthesis, and in this case you receive yellowish glass. It does not depend on pH. Dear colleagues, are there any questions? I want to ask the question. Evgeny Vasilievich, the first question concerning chains 1D0. They have a sort of stability, especially in natural conditions. I know uranyl compounds, we can obtain similar chains with other oxoanions. Why do they stable? What are the reasons for that? Please explain. Thank you very much for the question. The story is the following. These chains 1D0, there is a theory that uranyl compounds, especially when they built on combining tetrahedras and polyhedras, the complex is the same. It is shown in this light for MRRS cluster, and these chains 1D zeros, they are formed as a result of polymerization of these clusters. If you use four MRS clusters, you will receive all topologies of lead and chain compounds. This complex is very strong, sustainable. It is the first step towards polymerization. One more question, topological question. You mentioned from 43 different compounds, more than 40 compounds, we use the fragment structural unit. And other structural units, from the point of your frequency, did you analyze them? Is there a certain list which of them prevail and are realized in structures apart from this 1D0 complex? The situation is the following. More frequently, all these compounds are obtained from solutions. And they are built on the basis of layers. If you continue with the solution and the compounds recrystallize, for example, uranyl chromate system, and the end product will be built on the basis of 1D0 system. And among the layers, the most part of layers with the ratio of 2 to 3, I think that it is connected with the fact that in all synthesis, if it takes statistics of synthesis, they are made with the equal correlation of components. Different templates and aminos are used, and but correlations of uranium of TO4, there are some deviations, differences. I think that when researchers will work with different components, in the long run they will catch phases with different ratios, and chains 1D0 are most widespread in these compounds. And the last question. How many different topological types among 82 compounds you synthesized? Did you try to compare these typologies with other classes, non-uranium compounds? And topological motif is realized in other classes of compounds. We got used to analyzing compounds on the basis of uranyls. We built graphs and then topologies. We compare them We compare uranyl compounds. The answer is negative. We did not compare them. Apparently, if we take uramyl chromate dichromate, such dichromate levels are realized in compounds of wismut, kalium, sodium, and in non-uranyl systems, there are similar topologies. I think that program complex TOPOS will help us in this study. Olga Viktorovna, your question? You speak. The data show sustainability of uranium compounds. These phase compounds can be used for forecasting on phase formation in spent fuel and in the zones of oxidation of uranium deposits. Can you develop this idea? Are you planning to receive patent in this direction in the near future? It's a very good question. But in fact, we don't study spent fuel, and we can't study what is happening there. Spent fuel is filled with different uranylite. They can't be studied. We study liquid radioactive wastes, and we try to model this system. It is very complicated system. We find the limits of sustainability of some compounds there. Whether such compounds are formed there, it's a big question. Now, we can accumulate a lot of information here. This system is multi-component, and this liquid nuclear waste, they constantly contact with container. They accumulate cations, phase composition changes constantly. And what we have found, it is a small step in our research. Today, the humankind decided not to do anything with spent fuel. It is better to store it in a dry form. Mayak, Enterprise Mayak, is building storage facility in order to store spent fuel. Because to study spent fuel, it's a very complicated process. You have to separate, divide this valve, and the tube should be solved, should be put into the solution, and it leads to the formation of a large amount of waste. And we study the system from the theoretical point of view. Thank you very much for your answer. Distinguished colleagues online who are in the remote interactive mode, Natalia, do you have any questions? No questions. Mr. Thorsen, do you have any questions? No questions.
Yeah, it would be nice if I can raise one question. First of all, Yevgeny, thank you very much for this nice presentation. And so this condensed structural information you gave us. There is especially one special compound who raised my interest. If you could go to slide 40, there is this isopropylamine uranium chromyl chromate, where not only the structure is very interesting, but also We have chromium in two different oxidation states in this compound. We have chromium 5 and chromium 6. So I do not really remember how you have synthesized that, but having two oxidation states in one compound is quite unusual, which means there must be structural reasons or coordination reasons why we have these two different oxidation states. 40. Yes, so here you see it, and you gave it nicely in your formula also that you have chromium 5 and chromium 6. So how do these two oxidation states stabilize in that structure? And is there, because, so you see, when such compounds would be naturally formed, I would not expect two different oxidation states at what at one pH or whatever. So do you have any comment on that?
Thorsten, thank you very much for the question. The situation is very interesting here. In our experiments, we try to stabilize different uranyl phases with the help of templates. If we take some simple template as a propylamine and conduct experiments concerning evaporation, not quickly, not special ratios are placed into some glass. And if we start evaporating these solutions slowly, you saw that there are a lot of compounds with azepropylamine represented on the slides. They are able to localize many different topologies. And in this process, with the help of simple methods of thermic evaporation, this was obtained. In the very method, is nothing unusual. But we spent a lot of time, and when in crystallized solution, we obtained crystals, collect them, and study them. But the situation here was different. Initially, crystallized solution turned into gel. And you know that when chromate system turns into gel, we can't crystallize anything from it. Sometime later, the color of gel changed, and we obtained some small crystals. And as for bivalence of chromium, it is defined judging from the theory of valent connection. We have chromos of different valence. It is a characteristic of 5-valent chrome, and it is not characteristic of hexavalent chrome.
Thank you.
Thank you, Thorsten. And тогда, коллеги...
Dear colleagues, are there any questions? We have a lot of time. Thank you very much for your questions. Let us turn to the next point of our agenda. The speeches of board members with their reviews and the evaluation of the dissertation paper, and the speech of our candidate with questions and proposals to our candidate, and external reviews if there are. Partly the questions have been already asked, but we should observe formal things during our today's meeting. It's better to answer after each speech of the board member. All reviews were placed at the website of St. Petersburg University. Dear board members, please focus on the main moments concerning the dissertation paper. Do you have any objections? Dear board members, Let us turn to the reviews. The first floor is given to Olga Viktorovna Frank Kamenetskaya. Please start this procedure. Dear colleagues, of course, I'm not going to read out my full review. The work is very actual. It has a scientific novelty. Thank you. It has scientific novelty, topicality. It's of high scientific significance. Our candidate and his qualification is of no doubt. A huge volume of work was studied, and he has got a lot of publications. Only imagine, it is a peculiarity of this dissertation paper and our candidate. As for my questions, the first two questions, two remarks, they are connected with awkward, unsuccessful representation of tasks and aims and conclusion of the paper. As for aims and tasks, from my point of view, the formulation of tasks and aims are too general, and they don't reflect the specificity of their scientific novelty. And the conclusion is of mosaic character. We can't see the volume and scientific contribution of the work. Let us see the the names of these sections are very interesting, but the conclusion from my point of view is very poor. There are small remarks, for example, there are tables 3, 5, and 6, where parameters of elementary unit selves and angles, and in the methodological part of the work, there is an absence of information how you define the formulas of the compounds you studied. In conclusion, I want to say the dissertation paper of our candidate on the topic crystal chemistry of uranyl chromates, molybdates, and related compounds conforms with the requirements stated by the order. Procedure on awarding academic degrees in St. Petersburg State University, and our candidate deserves the degree of Doctor of Sciences, specialization 25005, mineralogy, crystallography. Olga Viktorovna, thank you very much for your feedback. I accept all your remarks. I agree with them. I would like to make an excuse. Our university accepted an opportunity to design the dissertation in the form of scientific report. That's why my conclusions were too vague. And we base our dissertation on the we write our dissertation on the basis of existing articles. And the matter is that when we write scientific articles, we study compounds not only in a structural way. As a rule, we conduct microzone research, qualitative or quantitative research. And when non-organic compounds are given most of the formulas of the studied compounds were determined on the basis of X-ray structural analysis data. The formulas obtained in the course of X-ray structural analysis were confirmed by the data of qualitative and sometimes quantitative microprobe studies. In a number of cases, a qualitative chemical analysis was carried out with the calculation of formulas. The calculation was performed using the standard method for a fixed number of nitrogen or oxygen atoms. For compounds templated with the organic molecules, infrared spectroscopy was used as an additional study. I am satisfied. Thank you. Thank you very much. Natalia Vitalievna, sorry for my mentioning that there is only one woman in the dissertation, but, well, I would like to give the floor to you now. You see that those board members who are in the remote interactive mode, sometimes I don't pay attention to them. Sorry for that. First of all, I would like to say that the dissertation itself, it is very bright and interesting research. It's very huge work, large amounts of material, new results are obtained. The work, the study is very impressive. But of course such work can't be free of some drawbacks. There are some inaccuracies in the work. I'm not going to list them because it is very serious work. Such a remark is very considerable. The first remark. As for the chains, there were questions 1DO and 1D1, crystal chemical peculiarities, derivatives from 1DO and 1D1. They are different. Poor voice in the microphone. Please explain some moments concerning these chains. And for example, page 59, why is H5O2 plus called hydronium ion? Why is it called hydronium ion? Hydroxonium, hexoxonium has the formula H3O, while H5O2 is designated as Zandl's cation. One more moment. Why did compound containing complex layers of the composition UO2 get into section 545, new metal inorganic frameworks in the structures of alkali metal molybdates? And as for conclusions, conclusion 2. The work shows that the factors providing the topological diversity of natural and synthetic uranium compounds with tetrahedral and pseudotetrahedral oxynes are variability of coordination of hexavalent uranium indicates that in the overwhelming majority of structures, the U6 cation exhibits linear coordination with the formation of uranyl ion, but all my remarks don't spoil the overall positive impression from the study, and the results of the study are very impressive. And the dissertation of Evgeny Nazarchuk on the topic crystal chemistry of uranyl chromates, molybdates, and related compounds conforms with the requirements stated by the order number 6821/1 from the 1st of September 2016, procedure on awarding academic degrees at St. Petersburg State University, and our candidate deserves the degree of Doctor of Mineralogical Sciences, Mineralogy, Crystallography. Thank you for your attention. Natalia Vitalievna, thank you very much. There are a lot of remarks. Let me look into my paper. As for the first remark concerning trivial provision and not very well formulated. In the text of the thesis, it was shown that regardless of the nature of the tetrahedral cation, the structure of these complexes reveals much in common. All these complexes can be built from a limited set of island and chain blocks, which apparently indicates the commonality of the crystallization processes of these compounds from aqueous solutions. Further development of this direction requires spectroscopic studies of crystallization solution directly, and we must create conditions in order to combine these complexes into necessary other complexes. Krivovich stated in his article, it is enough to create necessary conditions, and we managed to create such conditions in uranyl sulfide systems, and so the structure of such tubes is similar. And what are the conditions for creations of such nanotubes? We took layer 3, 2, 5, for example, and we obtained layer 5, 2, 8. Solutions have some properties, but it was not the task of the study to study it. As for the chains 1DO, when developing a model of microscopic crystallogenesis of uranyl selenates, Krivovich suggested that 4 MRS clusters are the basic building block for the construction of most uranyl selenate complexes. We made an attempt to develop these ideas and generalize them to all uranyl complexes with tetrahedral oxoanions. It is obvious that the polymerization of 4 MRS clusters along the direction leads to the formation of 1D zero chains. As for wrong name for iron axonium, I was mistaken. And as for island complex, if we take a layer and divide, in the overwhelming majority of structures, cation exhibits linear coordination with the formation of a uranyl ion. Although there are other types of coordination, for example, the tetroxide core. However, the uranyl ion itself in the equatorial plane is capable of having a sufficiently variable environment, which in many respects ensures the topological diversity of natural and synthetic uranium compounds with tetrahedral and pseudotetrahedral oxoanions. It is a separate case which works in a limited number of systems. As for uranium molybdate system, in one of the paragraphs I worked, I considered a framework and layered compounds, and these are two products of the same synthesis, and I wanted to show that under the same conditions they can realize different structures, and the task was to show the difference. As for conclusion two, topological diversity of uranyl compounds is not in many structures. There are tetraoxides, cores, nucleus, and it has uranyl, iron uranyl, and there can be mixed ligands templates, and it can provide topological diversity, and especially when they are mixed ligands, and for example, if we take layers 2, 2, 3, for example, and if we take the question concerning, well, that's all. Natalia, are you satisfied with the answer? Yes, I'm satisfied. Yes, I'm satisfied. And now the floor is given to Mr. Suleymanov. I would like to express my gratitude to the chairman for the invitation. It's very pleasant that it is happening within the walls of St. Petersburg University. I would like to highlight two most important results of this research. The first provision, our candidate obtained and many new uranium compounds. He contributed a lot into the development of our sciences, chemistry, mineralogy, crystal chemistry. And the second result is of qualitative character, generalizing the structural data about these compounds and about those which were studied before. Our candidate made specific conclusions. There is no instrument which would allow to forecast structures of compounds with this or that composition. Our science is developing extensively. We have to create new compounds and move forward. And in this respect, our candidate contributed a lot into the development of crystal chemistry of uranium. And our drawbacks is continuation of our strong points. It is strange for me that in the name of the dissertation there is no mentioning about cellulites. And the second, the dissertation is not only scientific, it is scientific and qualified work according to the tradition. We have to define what was studied before, what happened Next, to explain actual relevance of the study, and you have to show that without your contribution, it was impossible for science to develop further. And trying to and so the dissertation was written as a monograph. Well, but it's sometimes it does not fit in into the genre of the dissertations, and sometimes it is very difficult to assess the dissertation. And the third remark, the formulation of the aim, it starts with the words study or studying. It is a dissertation of doctoral level, and it seems to me that the terms should have been more categorical. You see, it is the dissertation. You should have chosen more serious words, but it is small drawback. And number four, the author uses word English words very often. Ligands coordinate, for example, ligands coordinate into uranyl grouping. You know that in the theory of complex compounds, everything is vice versa. It's not coordinated by ligands. I think that all these distortions of occur for the reason that you focus on a complex formation. Crystallochemistry of uranyl ion and anions define the character of structures. These are drawbacks, but they don't spoil the significance of the dissertation. According to the agenda, I have to the dissertation of Yevgeny Nazarchuk on the topic crystal chemistry of uranyl chromates, molybdates and related compounds conforms with the main requirements stated by the order 6821/1 procedure on awarding academic degrees at St. Petersburg University, and the candidate deserves the degree of the Doctor of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences. And this dissertation conforms with points 9 and 11. They were not violated by our candidate. I am for the degree. Yevgeny, the floor is yours. Thank you very much for the report. Right, you are that. I agree with your remarks. We use a lot of different organic templates, such as complexes which allow us to localize uranyl chromate structures and different topologies. Our task is more topological, to define the variety of topology, what are the conditions for the localization. For example, in the structures of uranyl compounds with tetrahedral oxoanions, it's not rare. For example, nitrate groups play an important role, in fact, controlling the stabilization of one or another topology. As for the composition of my dissertation, we have got such a format as a form of scientific reports. They don't involve writing a huge chapter concerning literature review. Of course, it would be better to state what was studied before me, especially concerning nanotubes. could not but focus on previous research. And when we describe each compound, we took into account previous scholars and so on. Thank you very much for the questions and answers. And now, Vladislav Blatov, the floor is yours. Thank you very much, Sergei Nikolaevich. It's a great honor for me to be invited here. I know Professor Krivovich, Sidra for a long time. And for me, it's a great honor to have the floor within the walls of St. Petersburg University. And the work itself deserves discussion. And we have discussed a lot about the advantages of this paper, a big volume of crystal structural data, 48 structures. This result is a unique. Nearly all the structures are non-organic, and even there are templates, they don't enter the complex of non-organic groupings. And taking uranyl compounds now are complex, and they contain different organic ligands. The obtaining of such a vast massive of information is very important from the point of view of understanding of mineralogy and structure formation. And it's one of the unique sides of the work. The second important moment for me as a person who deals with the methods of topological analysis of crystal structures, it was very pleasant to see in the paper parts devoted to topological analysis. Topology is the basis of this work, of the classification and understanding of this information. It's very important as well. These are two bright moments of the study, positive moments. And I would like to draw your attention to this fact, and they make this work unique. As for my remarks, there are several questions. I reflected them in my review and would like to voice them now. My colleagues have already mentioned them. And the question about the I have a question about the generalizing chapter in the dissertation on the analysis of the general and the different for all compounds. And you see that the format impedes the explanation concerning the study. It would be better to write separate chapters devoted to different compounds. It would be better to The second moment concerns topological analysis. You used your own approaches and the approaches of your scientific group, the names of topological types, the ways of their descriptions, they are a characteristic of this group. I would like to highlights the moment that in the sphere of topological analysis has been done a lot, and these analytical methods are automated, and I am sure that most of topological motifs which are reflected here, they are classified in topological databases, and to compare structures is possible automatically, as well as find structures which don't contain uranium, but they have the same topology. And with great pleasure, I want to cooperate with our candidate, and I want to try to find these structures. And it would be better to include the review concerning modern methods of topological analysis into the text of the dissertation. And for this class of compounds, the development of existing methods is necessary. For example, standard topological approach does not take into account the orientation of tetrahedras. You mentioned it in the text of your dissertation. It is very important from the point of view of a specific class of compounds. And there are private questions. They are reflected in my review. The term closed topology. It says that there is no clear definition of what topology is. You compare it to pictures and say that they are similar. Topologies are different, but the pictures are similar. You have to explain that these structures are close for this reason and so on. Most structures with uranium cation are centrally symmetrical. And when you have correlational number 5 in uranyl, it can't be centrally symmetrical to full extent. And why is its nature stipulates centra symmetrical character? Another moment. Page 159. Further evaporation of crystallite solution does not lead to the solution of the element. Some small remarks. They always present. On the whole, the work is fundamental and opens a new page in mineralogy of uranium, in crystal chemistry of uranium, and our candidate deserves the degree. The dissertation of Yevgeny Nazarchuk conforms with the requirements. The topic of the dissertation is crystal chemistry of uranyl chromates, molybdates, and related compounds. Dissertation conforms with the requirements stated by the order 6821/1 from the 1st of September 2016. Procedure on awarding academic degrees at St. Petersburg University, and our candidate deserves the degree in specialization 25005, mineralogy, crystallography. Points 9 and 11 were not violated by our candidate. Thank you very much for your feedback. As for topological analysis, it remains only to agree with the remark regarding the use of software systems and databases for the analysis of the structures of obtained during the dissertation. And the question about the centrosymmetry of uranium structures. The uranyl cation itself is centrosymmetric since it consists of a central uranium atom and two equidistant oxygen. Undoubtedly, the pentagonal uranium uranium pyramids cannot be centrosymmetric, and the uranium atom in such a coordination is never located in the center of the inversion. However, statistics show that the overwhelming majority of the structures of uranium compounds are centrosymmetric. The question is how the evaporation of the solvent can lead to the dissolution of the phase that has already precipitated out. The fact is that uranyl compounds obtained from aqueous solution by the method of isothermal evaporation, and especially templated compounds, often metastable. They are able to exist only in a very narrow range of conditions. Evaporation of the solvent actually changes the conditions which, according to our experience, especially with templated uranyl chromates, often leads to recrystallization of the resulting compounds. Thank you very much for the answer. Thank you. I am satisfied with the answer. And now our colleague from Germany, Mr. Thorsten, the floor is yours. Please comment upon the dissertation.
Yes, thank you very much for giving me the chance and to join this committee meeting, which is honestly the first time I'm doing that for some Russian colleagues, so I'm really honored to be here. First of all, you've seen or read my written report, and we have heard a lot of questions from the colleagues before, so I will just focus on three different points, probably. The first one is... It is impressive. So many structures have been synthesized, have been described, and have been compared to each other. Although in Germany we would do it a little bit different, nevertheless, I'm really satisfied with this work. Second point is there are still some weaknesses. So that there are always the small errors in these publications or presentations or monographs. This is clear that could not be avoided at all. But to my seeing on the thesis, I'm really impressed that the number of errors is quite small. But this is most probably on the other hand not surprising, as all the data have been published and many people read the manuscripts. But there is one point, and I mentioned that also in my review, is the given scope of the study. Although this is a very, very impressive work on crystal chemical investigation, synthesis, and structural characterization, the scope of the study was given as not only investigation of crystal structures and, wherever possible, thermal and spectroscopic properties of new compounds found. So the end of citation. Where possible is a widespreading wording which has been used. When possible could mean whenever I have time to do that, because on the other hand, if the equipment is there, then on every of these compounds at these spectroscopic investigation, physical properties could be investigated, although it's not the main topic of the thesis. Therefore, I think the scope of the study is, let's say, not chosen in an optimal wording. So this is a little bit of weakness. And the second thing is, although the thesis, third thing is, although the thesis focus on structural description and crystal chemical aspects of these uranyl compounds, and honestly, to my point of view, it doesn't care if there are some tellurides inside which are not named in the title, because that fits all to the chalcogenides which are used here. That's fine with me. But the question is, so on some of the compounds, thermal expansion has been modeled, and it has been named, and I mentioned that also in my review. So linear thermal expansion was found and modeled with a polynomial characterization of these things. Now, today, we have seen, and there's already one of the examples on the slide above there. It looks like it is linear. But nevertheless, I'm pretty much sure if one would take a polynomial of second order, one would see a slight bending also in these data. But we see also see that they are noisy. But the thing is that my criticism at this point is there are really modern developments. And I'm sorry that you just get a reviewer who is working in that field for a couple of years and develop all these models. There are physical models to describe thermal expansion using Debye-Einstein approaches or whatever. And this is probably something, some of those results have been developed in the time when all the models were developed, but nevertheless, when summarizing this dissertation here, I would have expected then that they would be re-evaluated and re-investigated with these more modern aspects of thermal expansion analysis. But honestly, this is only a very small weak point, because when you look to the data, you see they are nearly linear, but none of thermal expansion data are always linear. This is another side effect. It would be interesting, honestly, to see later on, or it would be nice that at least some of the data would be reinvestigating using these Debye-Einstein models, because also the Debye temperature would give you additional information about thermal stability of the materials, about heat capacity of the materials, about some Raman Grüneisen parameters, so bulk moduli of these materials. So there are many additional informations inside if you do thermal expansion correctly. But honestly, probably I'm pointing directly to this part, because this is a strong part also of our scientific daily work. And therefore, this is probably one thing I have seen intensively. Nevertheless, I'm fully satisfied with the thesis, and I'm completely there. And I also wrote it in the review. Although probably I did some formal mistakes, because I could not read all the regulations in Russian, and the English translation was also a little bit difficult to me. That I think that the doctoral degree in geological and mineralogical science 250025 should be awarded. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Thorsten and Evgeny. Zhenya, пожалуйста.
Thorsten, thank you very much for your review. I would like to answer the range of your questions. As for the texture of the sample, especially powder research, in most cases there were no texture. We tried to how could we avoid it. Well, I want to comment upon then. When carrying out powder studies, when receiving samples, in some cases, texturedness of the powder preparation was observed. In such cases, they were planted not from alcohol and tried not to press strongly against the substrates. In one of these questions, you asked, when we consider X-ray study, you see that the work is done in the form of scientific report and is based on published materials. Infrared spectroscopy, microprobe analysis, DTA and DSC were used in the study of compounds as auxiliary methods, confirming the data obtained in the course of X-ray structural and thermal X-ray studies. For a number of uranyl molybdates, DTA curves were obtained before the beginning of our studies. You know, for the rest of uranyl molybdates, as an additional characteristic, the articles provide data on powder X-rays diffraction at room temperature. For compounds templated with organic molecules, qualitative chemical analysis and infrared spectroscopic studies were performed to confirm the inorganic and organic components. Data on qualitative microprobe analysis are given for 20 compounds and for IR for 25. In some cases, for inorganic compounds, a qualitative chemical analysis was carried out with the calculation of formula, special formula. And as for physical properties described in chapter 7 as the thermal expansion of the phases above room temperature. You see, I probably did not articulate this part of the work very clearly. The paper claims that the temperature dependencies of the unit cell parameters are well approximated by polynomial of the first degree. Based on these dependencies, the main value of the tensors of thermal deformation of the structures were calculated. Tensors for different temperatures were not calculated. And as for spent fuel and compounds, the use of a wide range of fast templates, including molecules that are certainly not found in spent nuclear fuel, pursued several other goals. One of the directions of this work was an attempt to understand how the size and shape of the template affects the type of topology of the polyhedral structure. Both purely inorganic compounds and compounds templated by organic molecules are being investigated. Mr. Thompson, are you satisfied with the answer?
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you, Евгений Васильевич, спасибо большое. И теперь моя очередь дать небольшую оценку вашей работе. Мой отзыв, который висит на сайте университета, он короткий, как раз потому, что, собственно говоря, у меня замечаний каких-то особых, принципиальных к этой работе не было. Я давно знаком с Евгением Васильевичем и знаю его как великолепного исследователя, великолепного кристаллохимика, собственно говоря.
Brilliant crystal. He's very qualified specialist. The work is very brilliant, and it could not cover all the aspects of non-organic chemistry of uranium. And so the questions from my colleagues were concerning uranium. Of course, doctoral thesis, it is a great scientific achievement. I would like to highlight a very important, one important thing, apart from the fact that it is this step to understanding of six hexavalent chromium chemistry. And most part of the study of Evgeny of hexavalent chromium, it is concentrated around chromates and dichromates, and then tetrachromates were obtained. It is a great contribution. It is the chemistry of hexavalent chromium. It is more than the chemistry of uranyl. In my opinion, the dissertation is beyond crystal chemistry of uranyl. It covers non-organic chemistry in neighboring spheres. And some small S4 generalization. I know the format of dissertation, which is accepted at our university today. That's why I have no questions concerning the format. As for the specificity, accuracy, it's very different to measure pH in such systems. But if we speak about them, you mentioned some focus and architecture of compounds. And when we work with such strong backgrounds, bases, aminas, and so on, in my opinion, I understand the reason for that. Nevertheless, I want to hear your answer. Thank you very much, Sergei Nikolaevich. That's very interesting and important question. The answer is simple. And indeed, a number of theses have been carried out using various amines. It is well known that in aqueous solution, amines react reversibly with water. The medium of an aqueous solution of amines is slightly alkaline. However, the answer to this question lies in the details of the experiments, namely in the ratio of the initial components of the synthesis. We carried out synthesis by widely varying the ratio of reagents, including the ratio of amine to uranium and, for example, to chromium. Of course, not all the results obtained over the years were included in this thesis. The synthesis were carried out in 10-20 milliliters of distilled water. It has been experimentally established that if 0.5-0.9 grams of uranyl nitrate is dissolved in such a volume and the medium is brought to acidic with chromium oxide, then the addition of no more than 2 drops of amine from an insulin syringe, judging by the indicator paper, does not significantly change the acidity of the solution. Do you try alkaline system, like in case with wolfram? If you conduct experiments with chromates in alkaline systems, you will see always gel instead of crystals. You will receive, in the case of crown and even more as a crown ethers, repeated experiments led to gel-like masses. This dissertation is very brilliant. It will contribute a lot into non-organic crystal chemistry. That's why I hope that Evgeny Vasilyevich will continue further research in this direction. And let me voice the formal part. Dissertation of Evgeny Nazarchuk on the topic crystal chemistry of uranyl chromates, molybdates, and related compounds conforms with the requirements of the order from the 1st of September 2016, number 28-21/1, procedure on awarding academic degrees at St. Petersburg University. And our candidate deserves the degree of the Doctor of Mineralogy, Geological Sciences, Specialization 25005, Mineralogy, Crystallography, 0.9 and 11, were not violated by our candidate. It is the last Doctor of Sciences in this specialization, and because the something. Dear colleagues, and now technical break number 2. There is no signal. Mr. Thorsten, can you hear us?
Yes, no problem.
There is some technical distortion. Everything is okay, sorry. We continue our meeting. And as our defense is partly with the remote interaction mode, dear board members who are in the remote interaction, do you have any questions concerning our are there any external questions?
Not from my side.
No external questions, online questions. We have finished this part of our meeting. The speech of the scientific advisor, Oleg Sidra. Please tell us a few words about our candidate. Сергей Николаевич, thank you very much. You know that the work of Evgeny is brilliant. It's very rich in structures, types, unusual types. Uranium, it is an element which is which crystal chemists like. It's uranium is a very good material. Evgeny started studying uranium in 2002 when he was written his graduation paper under the supervision of Krivovich. Then he defended his candidate thesis in 2006. It was devoted to uranium. Then he had a break for 6 years. He became a businessman, and it was a break in his scientific career. In 2006, crystal chemistry was not very popular because there were no monocrystal diffractometers equipment. Thanks to Krivovich, these monocrystal diffractometers appeared at our department, and Evgeny decided to work with this modern equipment again. And in 2011, he managed to continue his scientific research. He wanted to continue his studies in this field of hexavalent uranium. Other classes of uranium compounds in those times had structural trends. At the beginning of the 21st century, it was clear how sulfate groups of uranium ions behaved. Later, Krivovich and Burns obtained hundreds of structures of selenates, molybdates, and they understood differences between these groups and molybdene chromates. We were not studied to full extent. There were separate articles on uranyl chromates even in 1970. In the 1970s, they were published by scientific group under Seryozhkin, Viktor Seryozhkin, but the structures were in limited quantity. In 2011, thanks to Evgeny, there was a burst of such new structural types of uranyl chromates, and they composed the core of Evgeny's dissertation paper. And as Evgeny showed today, it became the richest and diverse group of compounds which involves the peculiarities of other classes. And the peculiarity of the uranyl chromate topic and dissertation paper is semispheres. And board members paid attention to this. Before they obtaining these semispheres, it was considered that the formation of spherical clusters of uranyl systems is limited by peroxides, but it is not so. But of course, Evgeny's work is not limited by only chromates. Only 20 structural types were obtained among selenides, sulfates, and so on. As for sulfates, nanotubes were obtained. Before this study, first nanotubes were obtained in the middle of 2000s by Krivovich, three types of tubes, and after that, a lot of world scientific groups tried to obtain such nanotubes with other cations, but all attempts were in vain. Evgeny managed to analyze such unique and interesting structures, structural objects, of course. There is a question whether this work of mineralogical crystallography, all approaches which were used by Evgeny when he described structures of this diversity, graphs, moduli approach. But of course, with the help of comparison of the graphs, we understood that Cronkite chains and so on. And Evgeny managed to find the dependence structure of layers and organization of such layers, one went and character of polyhedrous combinations comes from the acidity of solutions. It is closely connected with biochemistry, mineralogy. In the structure of minerals, we can judge about the prerequisites for the formation of minerals. We can continue discussions for a long time about strong and weak points of the work, but I'm pressed for time. I want to say that, in my opinion, that this work deserves the degree of the Doctor of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences. Thank you. Oleg, thank you very much. Evgeny? Thank you very much. I have a question to board members. Maybe you have any questions? No questions. Dear colleagues, in the remote interactive mode, do you have any questions? No questions.
No, thank you.
Thank you very much. And the discussion and the receiving of questions has been finished. The next step of our agenda everything is okay in technical terms. Voting procedure. Dear colleagues, dear board members, we have the opportunity before the start of voting to announce a break to discuss the defense results with the broadcast sound muted. Do you think we need such a break to discuss the results of the defense? Do we need such a break in order to discuss the defense results? No, we don't need such a break. And if discussion of the results of the defense is not required, then we continue the meeting and proceed to voting, in this case, the opinion of each member of the dissertation council on this issue is voiced publicly and independently. Now it is 4:09 p.m. according to Moscow time. Please turn off the sounds of your microphones. Sorry. It's not so. Dear colleagues, our meeting continues. Please switch on the broadcast of the meeting, and the conclusive minutes are coming. Let us check that we can hear and see each other. I raise the question of awarding Evgeny Nazarchuk the degree of candidate of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences in the Specific Specialization 25005 Mineralogy Crystallography to an open roll call. And if you vote for, you agree that point 11, procedure on awarding academic degrees at St. Petersburg State University, has not been violated by the candidate. In the dissertation, our candidate has to refer to the author or source of materials or separate results when he uses the results of scientific works and in co-authorship, the candidate has to note this circumstance. The decision, I remind you that the decision of the dissertation council on the issue of awarding an academic degree is considered positive if more than half, but at least three members of the dissertation council who participated in the meeting voted for it, in accordance with clause 23 of the procedure. Board member Frakaminetskaya Olga, your opinion? I'm for. Board member Vladislav Blatov, I'm for. Board member Zubkova Natalia Vitalievna, your opinion? I'm for. Board member Suleymanov, Evgeny Suleymanov, I'm for. Our foreign colleague, board member Torsten Gizing, please give your opinion.
I am for.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Torsten. And me, as chairman of the dissertation council, Sergey Britvin, I am for the degree. And counting thus, distinguished colleagues and guests, I announce that out of six board members participating in the voting, six members voted for, no one voted against, and no one abstained from vote. Thus, the decision on awarding an academic degree of the Doctor of Geological and Mineralogical Sciences, 25, specialization 25005, mineralogy crystallography, is accepted. Evgeny, the floor is yours, the final word. Dear colleagues, dear board members, chairman, thank you very much for the opportunity to have the floor today and for your attention to my dissertation paper. I would like to express my gratitude to the colleagues who participated in my study. Thank you very much. Dear colleagues, let us congratulate our candidate on this event. Thank everyone, thank you very much for participation. Evgeny, thank you very much for brilliant report. The meeting is declared closed. Please switch off the live broadcast of the meeting.